Welcome back, guys. In this video, we will see fibrinolytics and antifibrinolytic drugs. But before we start, first tell me, what's tissue plasminogen activator and what's plasmin? If you cannot remember them, I highly recommend to watch the video on physiology of clot retraction and fibrinolysis, especially the fibrinolysis part. And if you already know them, let's proceed. Let's say your patient has an unwanted clot in his blood vessel. It is obstructing the blood flow, so you want to get rid of it. Drugs you will use for this are fibrinolytics, the first topic of this video. It includes streptokinase, urokinase, alteplase, reteplase and tenecteplase. First we will see each drug's individual features, which will mainly be the mechanism of action. And then we will see common features like uses, adverse events and contraindications. So let's see the streptokinase first. It is the first fibrinolytic drug to be used clinically. It is obtained from group C beta-haemolytic streptococci. Now let's see how it works. It is given by intravenous route. In blood, it binds with plasminogen. Then it induces conformational changes in it that exposes its active site. Then this complex activates other plasminogen molecules to plasmin. Now, the plasmin has a lysine binding site and fibrin has lysine residues. Plasmin binds with these residues through its lysine binding site. Then through catalytic site, it cuts the fibrin strand. Likewise, fibrin strands are broken all over. This leads to clot dissolution and the blood flow is restored. So that's how the streptokinase works. Now let's see the disadvantages of streptokinase. It is not fibrin specific. Apart from activation of plasminogen in clot, it also activates plasminogen in circulation. As such, under physiological condition, alpha-2 antiplasmin keeps the activity of circulating plasmin under control. It first binds with the lysine binding site of the plasmin and then blocks the catalytic site. But today it's not a physiological condition. Today we have given plasminogen activator from outside on top of body's own plasminogen activators. So there is massive production of plasmin in circulation. Now even after consumption of entire pool of alpha-2 antiplasmin, there will still be active plasmin remaining in the circulation. This produces a systemic catalytic state in which clotting factors like fibrinogen, factor 5 and factor 8 are degraded. Without these clotting factors, coagulation is impaired, which may lead to bleeding. The streptokinase increases the risk of hemorrhage. Next disadvantage. If patient had recent streptococcal infection, he might have developed anti-streptococcal antibodies. In such patients, large proportion of streptokinase is inactivated by these antibodies. This reduces the efficacy of streptokinase therapy. So it cannot be used within 1 year of streptococcal infection. Moreover, streptokinase itself is also antigenic. So there is production of anti-streptokinase antibodies in few days. In such patient also, subsequent dose of streptokinase might not work. So if once used, it cannot be repeated from 5 days to 1 year after that. Such patients need to use alternate fibrinolytics. Other adverse events like hypersensitivity, for example anaphylaxis and arrhythmia, can also occur. Because of these disadvantages, streptokinase is rarely used now. The only advantage with this drug is it's cheap. So this was streptokinase. Now let's move to the next drug, urokinase. Earlier it was obtained from human urine, but now it's obtained from cultured human kidney cells. Let's see how it works. In contrast to streptokinase, it acts on plasminogen directly and converts it into plasmin. Later steps are same. Plasmin degrades fibrin, which leads to clot dissolution. Nothing more for urokinase. Next, alteplase, reteplase and tenecteplase. Alteplase is basically tissue plasminogen activator produced by recombinant DNA technology. Reteplase and tenecteplase are modified versions of alteplase. They have longer half-life, so they can be given bolus in contrast to all other drugs which are given by continuous infusion. Now let's see how they work. In blood, they have very low affinity for plasminogen. However, in clot, they bind with lysine residues on fibrin. After binding, they activate the plasminogen more rapidly. Once we have plasmin, you know what happens. Fibrinolysis and clot dissolution. So these were some distinct features of individual drugs. Remaining points are common for all. First, uses. Fibrinolytics are commonly used in myocardial infarction. If possible, they should be given within 1 hour. Their efficacy decreases as time passes. They are also used in peripheral arterial thromboembolism, acute ischemic stroke, deep vein thrombosis and pulmonary embolism, and to restore catheter and shunts that are occluded by blood clot. In general, they are more effective on venous thrombi than on arterial thrombi, and on recent thrombi than on older thrombi. Now let's see the adverse events of fibrinolytics. A major side effect of fibrinolytics is bleeding. There are two reasons behind it. First, along with pathological thrombi, patient would have physiological thrombi that are preventing bleeding from breaks in blood vessel. Fibrinolytic drugs do not see any difference between them. They lyse both of them. Dissolution of pathological thrombi is good, but dissolution of physiological thrombi causes bleeding. Second reason is, apart from clot, fibrinolytics produce plasmin in circulation also. And as we have seen, clotting factors like fibrinogen, factor 5 and factor 8 are degraded by this circulating plasmin. This leads to impaired coagulation, which in turn contributes to bleeding. Other adverse events are hypotension and fever. Next, contraindications. Fibrinolytics are contraindicated in patients with history of intracranial bleeding, ischemic stroke in past 3 months, brain tumor or vascular abnormality, bleeding disorders, active bleeding, head trauma, peptic ulcer, esophageal varices, recent internal bleeding, metastatic cancer, uncontrolled hypertension, and pregnancy. So this was all about fibrinolytics. I hope it was clear so far. Now let's see the drugs which have opposite function, antifibrinolytics or inhibitors of fibrinolysis. In this we have epsilon aminocaproic acid and tranexamic acid. They are lysine analogs. Let's see their mechanism of action. We know that plasminogen and plasmin have lysine binding site through which they associate with lysine residues on fibrin. These drugs occupy this lysine binding site, so they cannot bind with fibrin. Also, they bind the lysine binding site in tissue plasminogen activator. So neither the tissue plasminogen activator can bind with fibrin. Thus, antifibrinolytics keep all these destructive molecules away from clot. So clot remains intact. They are used when you want to prevent bleeding, like in patients with hemophilia, bleeding from fibrinolytics, menorrhagia, recurrent epistaxis, hyphema, peptic ulcer, bleeding after prostatectomy, tooth extraction or tonsillectomy, and cardiopulmonary bypass surgery. Now adverse events. A common problem with these drugs is thrombosis. In patients with hematuria, unlysed clot may cause ureteral obstruction leading to renal failure. Other adverse events are gastrointestinal distress, myopathy, and hypotension when given by intravenous route. This completes both the topics of this video. Time for summary. Fibrinolytics are drugs that dissolve clot. They all are given by intravenous route. Streptokinase is obtained from group C beta hemolytic streptococci. It complexes with plasminogen and then that plasminogen activates other plasminogen. It is less fibrin specific as compared to other drugs. It should not be used for 1 year after streptococcal infection or streptokinase use due to antibodies. It also causes hypersensitivity reaction like anaphylaxis. Because of all these disadvantages, it is rarely used now. However, it is very cheap. Urokinase is obtained from cultured human kidney cells. Alteplase is recombinant tissue plasminogen activator. Reteplase and tenecteplase are modified versions. They have longer half-life and can be given bolus. In circulation, they have less affinity for plasminogen. However, in clot, they bind with lysine residues on fibrin, which increases activation of plasminogen. Fibrinolytics are used in myocardial infarction, peripheral arterial thromboembolism, acute ischemic stroke, deep vein thrombosis and pulmonary embolism, and to restore catheter and shunts. They are more effective on venous thrombi than on arterial thrombi, and on recent thrombi than on older thrombi. Adverse events of fibrinolytics are bleeding due to dissolution of physiological clot and systemic lytic state, fever and hypotension. They are contraindicated in patients with history of intracranial bleeding, ischemic stroke in past 3 months, brain tumor or vascular abnormality, bleeding disorders, active bleeding, head trauma, peptic ulcer, esophageal varices, recent internal bleeding, metastatic cancer, uncontrolled hypertension and pregnancy. Now, antifibrinolytics. Drugs in this group are epsilon aminocaproic acid and tranexamic acid. They are lysine analogs. They bind with lysine binding site of plasminogen and plasmin as well as tissue plasminogen activator. It prevents their binding with fibrin, so fibrinolysis is prevented. They are used in hemophilia, bleeding from fibrinolytics, menorrhagia, recurrent epistaxis, hyphema, peptic ulcer, bleeding after prostatectomy, tooth extraction or tonsillectomy, and cardiopulmonary bypass surgery. Their adverse events are thrombosis, renal failure in patients of hematuria, gastrointestinal distress, myopathy and hypotension. That's it friends for this video. Also check out entire playlist on hemostasis and drugs affecting it. And don't forget to subscribe and share the video. Thanks for watching. See you in next video.